Grisha?
No, there's an owl. Oh no, it's a gymnogy. Why did I just get it wrong? So, that is the African Harrier Hawk, now hiding behind the branch over there, quite successfully. He'll come out into the open now. There we go. His yellow face. And what he's doing is hanging upside down over there. These birds are almost specially made or purpose-built to access hole nesting birds. And we were talking about the lilac-breasted roller busy nesting in holes in trees. And there's obviously a hole in a tree there that some birds have a nest in. And this African Harrier Hawk is now trying to get whatever's in that nest out under mobbing pressure from the inhabitants or the current inhabitants of the nest. Now, who's nesting there is a Burchell starling. And have a look at how that bird can hang upside down. I mean, he's totally upside down at the moment, using a combination of his feet and his beak to try and get into the hole or into the cavity, all the while being mobbed by that Burchell starling, and who's about to be joined by a drongo. It's actually quite fascinating to see. To be honest with you, to see them for this long is actually quite rare, so this is actually quite a good sighting. Yeah, there he flies off. It hasn't flown off just yet. Let's see if he's actually managed to excavate a baby from that. Hole. I think he'll get a gap from the front here. There we go. Nice view in the light. I don't see anything clutched in his talons. No, nothing clutched in his talons. And there he flies off to his next branch with the host of... There he comes. He's actually going to land here in front of us. Awesome. Let's see if we can get a bit closer. I don't think we're going to disturb them. They're actually birds that don't mind, don't get flustered too much. You can actually see his face changing color. They're one of the very few birds whose faces can change color with their mood. And his face is going from bright yellow to red. No, man, how way are you going? So, and that's the end of that then. So, here we go. Lilac-breasted roller calling above us. We've obviously come into the middle of a bird party. There's been a lot of birds here at the moment. There's a striped cuckoo. One for the birders, if I can ask Andrew to turn around. This is quite rare to see, actually. One for the birders in the group. I know for those of you who follow Scott, he'd be quite proud to add this. That is either a striped or a Jacobin cuckoo, and I'm just going to be taking out my bird book while you're busy trying to grab screenshots of that bird. And I think that it is probably the striped cuckoo. I'm going to tell you that now. The African cuckoo, Kong cuckoo. Look at his crest, the Jacobin cuckoo. So that's what we're busy having a look at the moment. The Jacobin cuckoo, I'm going to be showing you here. This is the Jacobin cuckoo. We're looking at this particular one right here. Right, and they've literally just arrived. And have arrived to make use of all the hairy caterpillars that we have around at the moment. That is their prey, predominantly their prey source, is hairy caterpillars, which I have seen an absolute profusion of for the last couple of weeks. And that's what they'd be combing through the their bush for. And there's the sound that it makes. These guys are brood parasites, which means that they don't look after their own babies. They actually lay their eggs in the nests of other birds. And the Jacobin cuckoo parasitizes the bulbul. So what he would do, or what that cuckoo would do is fly around looking for hairy caterpillars during the breeding season, which happens about now. What they'd do is they'd search for their particular host bird, which in this case would be a bulbul. The bulbul's nest would be attacked and one of the eggs kicked out, or even all of the eggs kicked out by the cuckoo. The cuckoo would then lay their egg inside the nest, which looks almost identical to the bulbul's egg. The bulbul will come back then and realize, hey, but my eggs are still here. Incubate the egg and actually hatch the egg and bring up and feed the cuckoo's baby, which quite often is much bigger than the host bird. You can't imagine that the parent bird, the bulbul, looks at this cuckoo, obviously a different shape, and brings it up. But they do, you know, in a very successful way of breeding. Cuckoos are fairly common out here. All right, and from birds from the Jacobin cuckoo to James on the bushwalk. He's got an update on his dung topic for the day. James, you know, you can find the most interesting things. We'll see you in a bit.
It sounds to me like you have been having the most fantastic time with Stef and the Gymnogene / African Harrier Hawk. Really special stuff to see them mobbing or trying to get into a nest with those double-jointed intertarsals, as I'm sure Stef explained to you. Now, we have come across yet more dung, and the interesting thing about this dung, just following on from the dung conversation, the beetle conversation we were having earlier, is that in the height of the summer, this dung would not maintain this kind of shape. It would have been flattened by now, because of the actions of the beetles. Now I think, as you can see, the sun has come out and it's turning into rather a balmy day. This kind of temperature will encourage the beetles that are below the ground to come up and start to really fizz around and fly around and eat the dung and start to, you know, get on with eating it and the heavy business of breeding. And that's basically what dung beetles are born to do, other than eat dung. That's what we're all born to do. And they will flatten a piece of dung like this completely onto the ground, and it will be very crushed into very fine little particles. And the other interesting thing I wanted to show you about it is that this elephant is clearly still eating a majority of sticks. It's not eating anything in the way of grass yet, and that's just indicative of the fact that we haven't had the proper rains yet, so the grass is not long enough for the elephants. Elephants would much rather be eating grass than they would sticks that grind away at their teeth and eventually will, you know, play a role in reducing their lifespans. You can see a huge piece of stick in there. It just gives you an idea of how poor an elephant's digestive system is. Right, now, over there, I'm just lying very comfortably in the new rays and warmth of the sun. You can see the Drakensberg Mountains, and they look very crisp and clear today, and that's because of the front, cold front that we've just had coming through this area. Right, while we walk along, I believe there are a few queries about dung beetles, so we'll try and discuss those, and we'll walk gently along this road, and we'll tell you what we can tell you, and perhaps see a few more interesting little bits and pieces. atmosphere has changed completely from that early morning expectancy. Ooh, Brian, I don't think I'm going to try and make you film that. It'll make everyone ill. But it's a red-breasted swallow. A little pair of red-breasted swallows has just flown over. I suspect they've been visiting some mud in a little mud wallow, and they'll go and... Have you got him? Well done.
Something else flying.
Oh, that's definitely not a red-breasted swallow. That's a fairly substantial bird. I've lost my binoculars again. Hang on. I'll go and tell you what they are. That actually looks like a vulture, Brian. I think it looks like a white-backed vulture to me, if I was to have a guess. And they, of course, will now start to fly because the day is starting to heat up a bit. So they can find some thermals. It is a white-backed vulture. What a relief. And I don't know the kind of detail you saw on it there, but it's molting a little bit. You can see it's missing a couple of the primary flight feathers. And they do molt from time to time. Those feathers need to be replaced. And the birds are very fastidious, especially vultures, about making sure that the feathers are in good condition. They preen a lot. Vultures will sit with their wings hanging out like this, which helps the filaments of the feathers to realign themselves. But every so often, a feather gets so worn down that it has to be shed, and then it will grow another one in its place. They don't kind of replace on a continuous basis like our hair does, so they do lose feathers, and you'll always see a bird with a gap or two in its primary feathers, and that's from the replacement, from the shedding of those old feathers. Now, over here is a red-billed buffalo weaver's nest, and I think it's unoccupied. But interestingly, they tell you that a red-billed buffalo weaver's nest are basically as reliable as a compass. They will be on the northwestern side of a tree no matter where you are, and that's precisely where this one is. We don't really know why. I think it's got quite a lot to do with heat balance within the nest. It's basically a block of flats, and if you're on the northwestern side of the tree, what you do is you pick up the afternoon sun in the winter time, because the sun sets to the north there, and so it keeps you warm for as long as it can before the night comes. Then the sun shifts, of course, during the course of the summer months, and actually sets over there. And if this tree had, this tree is dead, and that so it doesn't have any foliage in it, but the sun sets off to the southwest now, and in the summertime that means that your home is then shaded, which is quite nice. Let's quickly go across to Stef. He's got some playing elephants. Wonderful stuff. We'll carry on along the road here.
Have a look at what we've just bumped into over here. It's this elephant are having a game with one another. And the one is actually laying down, and he's got some friends that are not wanting to... Whoa. We got some impala causing some panic. Oh, we got this elephant chasing around the impala. Epic. Let me turn the car. And I've just been told something so interesting. It's Jess's last drive sitting in the Johannesburg office today. And all she wanted to see was a baby elephant. So here's a big shout out to Jess. On your last drive, I'm glad we managed to do that for you. And we obviously wish you luck in your new endeavor, and we'll see you when you get back soon. So what is happening? Why have we got chaos happening at the moment? Why are these impala running around like mad things? The answer is quite simple, in that female is going to drop her baby very, very soon. Have a look at this. Ah, we got some stotting. Awesome. So what's happening is the females are increasing, or having an increase in their estrogen. And this is creating this protective instinct in this male. And it's actually just going to get worse as the females near dropping their lambs, which will happen any day now, to a point where the female gets harassed almost non-stop and then will eventually manage to leave the herd. She will then drop her baby, usually in the middle of the day. And they will all drop their babies, well, the majority of them at least, anyway, will drop their babies within a couple of days of one another. And you get these nursery herds of babies that then form. So that behavior that we saw there, this wild running around, this male chasing this very pregnant lady, is just telling me that we are fast approaching the time where we get to see some baby impala again. And I can't wait. They are very, very cute for a couple of days. Now, we are literally surrounded by elephants. I've got Andrew, who's supposed to be looking through the camera's head on a swivel, his elephant coming at us from all directions. Quite tough to see, but we are about 50 feet from five or six elephants at the back of the car, and they are approaching us. They're going to feed right up onto the car, it looks like. Have a look. I'm missing it. Sorry, guys, there's just so much going on over here. This just doesn't know where to point. We don't know where to point the camera. There's a female elephant coming out of the bush, and let's see. There we go. Okay, so what you're looking at there is called stotting. It's a show of strength and fitness. I'm actually quite glad that we got to see that. It's quite rare to film. Let's see if these ones on the left start doing it. It just takes one.
Yeah, they come back.
And here they all come back at the back of the group, all still stotting. Wonderful. And what that is, literally, it's just to show predators how fit and how strong they are. It's just exuberance at the beginning of this, at the beginning of the season. Some energy to spare. Oh, here we go. Male chasing another very pregnant female. Oh, shame. I must say, I feel for them. It's not easy. Here they go again, bounding around. And this is just a reaction. Too much estrogen eliciting these. A lot of good food at the moment. They're all healthy and happy because of the season that's changed. Getting ready to have their babies. And that stotting behavior is almost infectious. It's that bound. Now, it has been proven, not here, but it has been proven that impala that have been stotting are not targeted by predators in the area. So it's a show of force that, excuse me, another ambush. Excuse me there, I should warn you when a sneeze is coming. and it has been proven that predators definitely ignore these animals that have been stotting and favor animals that haven't. Listening around us, we've got elephant feeding, a lot of elephant. We've got these impala going crazy, another group of elephants standing on the other side of the impala, and then we also have trumpeting elephants, wildly trumpeting elephants in the distance just on the other side of this group. So a lot is actually going on right here at the moment. I don't quite know what it is, which is why I was trying to be quiet and listen. I think let's go and see if we can get into the middle of this herd of impala. Generally, this time of the year, you can actually see the babies kick inside the tummies, and I always quite enjoy that. It's lovely to witness. I'm going to see if we can get to see some elephant while we are looking at one of these baby impala in the tummy. female in front of us has enormous tusks. She's beautiful. There we go. Sitting in the thick of it, for lack of a better word, we've got easily 20 elephants around us at the moment, and probably close on 50 impala or so. That youngster that you're having a look at the moment, just using his newfound skills with his trunk and his foot, probably just having copied mom do exactly the same thing over the last couple of weeks. Now, elephant will eat roughly about 80% of their diet this time of the year of woody species of plants, so leaves, bark, roots, and wood. But as the grass grows, and look at what she's doing, she's now digging a trench. And in that trench is going to be some roots.
That, but it looked like the youngster was eating there, and then the older one chased it off, then the mother chased the other older one away.
Yeah, it is quite weird that, but it's I think they were just having a game, and I think what happened is you had these impala run in and create a little bit of confusion. And of course, as soon as elephants get confused, they follow the lead of the matriarch. And almost getting into a corral position there, which is where the babies go into the middle and the other elephants put their bums around the babies and face their tusks and their trunks outwards. But then they just decided to move off. They realized that these impala were just playing around. Gilly in Wisconsin has just asked why there's such a big difference between African and Indian elephant, and is it because Indian elephants have been domesticated and have been ridden by man, which gives them that characteristic concave back? Gilly, the answer to that is no. I don't think that elephants have had enough domestication to have actually physiologically being changed by it, the Indian elephant. The Indian elephant and the African elephant are different from one another basically because of the habitats that they live in, and they are completely different species. You can see this elephant's ear has been, I'm trying to see if it's been folded over. It's actually been cut. Can you believe it? Now, that could actually have happened in any number of ways. The most common way for that to happen is actually fire or a massive injury. So elephants do get caught in bushfires from time to time, and being the thinnest skin on the elephant's body, you might find that that the ear was damaged in some way, or it was caught on a branch and quite badly ripped. And between oxpeckers and her fiddling with it, her ear is actually torn off. Apart from a slight decrease in the ability for the elephant to thermoregulate, which is what they use their ears for, that will have no further effect on that elephant. She's absolutely fine, as you can see, in very robust health, and with a baby in tow. So it hasn't had any marked effect on her. But what an interesting phenomenon. I've never seen an ears so badly damaged without any further evidence of damage on an actual elephant. So that's actually quite nice to see, a half-eared elephant. Quite bizarre. And as you can see, the pit or the trench that she dug and used slightly to dig some roots and then to have a dust bath in is now being inspected by another youngster. He's now also using it to have a bit of a dust bath. Had a small little dust bath and then moved on. Here we have an elephant that is quite characteristic. Off on our left hand side, it's that one elephant that has that skew tusk, or that tusk that's facing backwards. And we have seen her throughout the season. There are actually a number of elephants here that have that tusk. This is the one with a notch in the tusk. She's actually using that backward facing tusk to feed. What amazes me, and I'll be honest with you, this particular elephant is how, when in flight, so when in panic, this elephant doesn't impale her leg with that tusk. I can only imagine it's because she has learnt at the exact angle which to hold her head when she's running. But I can't even see any scarring on her leg which would say to me that that was a lesson hard learned. So she's got one incredibly long tusk that she rests on her leg with a notch in it because she's utilized it as a very handy tool, obviously, judging from that notch and how well that notch has been used. And doesn't hurt herself when she runs blindly. And I mean, elephant, they can panic and they can run panicked into the bush. And she obviously is not hurting herself at all, which is just astounding. I've been marveling at it since I first saw her a couple of months ago. Funnily enough, my impression of Juma is that there are quite a few elephant here with tusk anomalies. I'm actually at a loss to explain why. It's not for inbreeding. Juma is not an enclosed reserve whatsoever. We sit on the fringes of the Kruger National Park, in what we call the Greater Kruger National Park. Here we've got these impala sailing past us again. Jumping over the trees. Now the Greater Kruger National Park is also open to a number of other privately owned reserves, the Timbavati, the Baluli, the Klasiri, not only the Sabi Sands, it's also open to reserves in other countries, the Limpopo Transfrontier National Park, the Greater Limpopo Transfrontier National Park, which is in Mozambique. And actually has game corridors all the way through to Gonorezo in Zimbabwe. So the elephants here definitely are not interbreeding with one another at a point where you'd actually start to find birth defects happening. So this tusk deformity that we're seeing at the moment is either hereditary, in other words, it's being passed down generation to generation, or it's from some other type of mineral deficiency. I'm just seeing too much evidence. Too many different elephants are here with backwards facing tusks. There must be about, for those of you who've been watching a long time, you could help me out here, but there must be probably about 3 to 5 full-grown female elephants this size that have these tusk deformity. And to me, that just says that it's hereditary. It's passed down from mothers, very successful mothers like this, in actual fact. Old cows that have had many, many babies, passing down the gene for a skewed tusk or a deformed, as we would see, a deformed tusk. Obviously, she doesn't think it's a deformity whatsoever. She's using it as a very handy tool. impala running around. Once again, excuse us for zipping about the screen like this. It's just to try and catch all the action of these impala doing their thing. So Dr. Debbie has asked, looking at these impala jumping around like mad, if stotting has anything to do with nesting behavior. You know, this is a general energy boost that that animals having babies seem to get. And I'd have to say yes in this particular instance, because stotting is only really evident when predators are around. I've only actually seen animals stot when leopard or lion or cheetah parade in front of them. And I'd say that this morning, apart from the weather being fairly cool and there being a lot of just good vegetation around at the moment, I would say that the stotting behavior is absolutely that. So well done, Dr. Devi. I think it's we can attribute it to it. I don't see any evidence to provide me with an answer to the contrary. But there they all come back again. They're literally just running from one side of the vehicle to the other, not really even going anywhere. I've got some male impala coming. His male impala is chasing another one of his females back. All right, so we've got this big female at the moment coming towards us. The impala are creating a little bit of confusion. This is male impala. You might actually hear what they do. You see male impala on the fringe of this herd are just roaring at one another. That is an old female and probably one of the nicest views of her that we've got. Now let's see what she allows us to do. Have a look at how she gets her head and tusk out of the way of her leg. No, don't start this behavior with us, we're just watching you. So what I'm worried about at the moment with an elephant like this is displacement anger. So she's nervous with these impala creating confusion in the bush, and what she's going to do is take it out on a soft target. And I don't want that soft target to be us. Elephants are renowned for displacement anger. And although I'm not expecting anything untoward from her, I definitely need to keep it in mind. I just noticed, have a look at the way she walks and keeps her tusk away from her leg. I mean, it's within inches of puncturing her leg. And look how sharp that tusk is. And we definitely have seen this elephant many, many times before. It's diagnostic that notch in the tusk. But have a look at that edge, that knife edge on that tusk. And there is absolutely no evidence of it puncturing her leg. I just find that phenomenal. For me, that's the most amazing thing with this particular elephant. Is when panicked, an elephant panic a lot, how she doesn't stab her own leg is just beyond me. Anna Marie has asked if I've ever seen weirdly tusked elephant bulls and not just females. Anna Marie, absolutely. I've seen bull elephants with tusks not quite as bizarrely shaped as this one, but you do get bull elephant with tusks that are crossed over, that are highly bent up in any one particular direction. I've even seen an elephant with two tusks bent down, but not quite with the same, I would say, exaggeration as I have seen with this particular elephant. She's definitely a very special elephant. One beautiful tusk and one tusk that is very long and just as pretty, but faced in the other direction. And she does use that tusk. There's lots of notches on that tusk that she uses it. the temperature heating up. My old favorite, the faithful flies, have started to come in and are making their presence known. You'll notice from the bushes that started to shake in front of you, we've got some wind that's blown in from somewhere. And the clouds, where they were striated this morning, have now become nice and fluffy. You see, over these elephants, you'll notice the clouds coming in. They're quite low, not very high off the ground. And we'll see what that does throughout the course of the day. You don't actually know what's going on. There's two elephants busy wrestling with one another, just two youngsters, trunks intertwined. Much the same with any play that we witness with babies. It's all just practice for when they get a bit older and the males have to start wrestling with one another for mating rights. It's all a bit of play and practicing. You can see them pushing against one another there, joined by a third one. Ashley in North Carolina has asked how many muscles are in an elephant trunk. It's a question that I can answer in two ways, in actual fact. How many muscles in terms of how many different types of muscles that you've got in an elephant's trunk, or how many muscle fibers or muscle bundles that you've got? As far as I know, in terms of muscle bundles, there are about 100,000 different type muscle bundles inside that elephant trunk. So a very densely muscled appendage. How many different types of muscles in an elephant trunk? They have almost every type of muscle fiber that you can get, even one that's specific to just elephant, a helical muscle. So they've got muscles that can contract and expand, they've got muscles that can swell up and constrict, and then they have a helical muscle that can concertina their trunk out, not just expand it in a straight line. So, and they have every type of muscle fiber that mammals produce, elephants have, including one that's unique to elephants, that helical muscle that's in their trunk. So I hope that answered your question. It's actually very peaceful where we are at the moment. You'll notice that as Andrew swings the camera around, these impala that we drove into are now literally about 15 feet away from us. It's a young male. He was born last year. He's about to get some brothers and sisters. And made it through his first year of life. Something that 50% of his cousins didn't up to this time. And is one of the reasons why impala all mate within a rut season, so they all mate, they're mated with at the same time, and all have their babies around the same time as well, is that they glut the system with youngsters. And have all their babies at around about the same time, which satiates all the predators and give the babies that do survive a much better chance of just getting through those first couple of weeks. Have a look how close we are to these impala. I mean, she's just, isn't she beautiful? The roaring that we would have heard a little bit earlier with those male impala is exactly the same noise that they make during the rutting season. Lewis in Buffalo remarked on that. Now, although impala have quite a wide repertoire of calls, they make a soft mewling noise when they have babies. they also have that roaring noise that you hear that the male will exhibit. Here he comes here. Got his tail fluffed out. Beautiful male. Keeping all his ladies in check. There we go. As you saw that, you would have noticed that in May during the rut, that behavior with that little roar that he gave there. And he would have, at the moment, ostracized all the young males, immature males and the young males, off to one side. And that's exactly what he's busy doing over here now, is corralling the males away from the females. His tail's fluffed out, giving a little bit of a roar. He's probably going to burst into flight chasing something right now. But what he's effectively doing is he's cutting out all the young males and forcing them to go to the periphery. He's now just brought to his female's back, and I see he's actually got a wound on his side from a fight. So near miss with one of his just looks like it scraped the hair there. Didn't look like it did any damage. A near miss was one of his challenges. It would have been one of the more mature males that he would have had a tussle with. And their horns are so devilishly sharp that even just a little bit of a mistiming when they clash horns together would have produced that. Now have a look at that gland. Can't really see it over here. Let me move a little bit. Andrew says that he's going to be able to shut. Oh, there you go. You can see that black gland on the back foot. That is a tarsal gland. It's not really known why impala have that gland. I've heard a variety of different explanations or hypothesis. The one that I enjoy the most would have to be the fact that as an impala jumps at night time to avoid predators, they are able to smell that of their compatriot in front of them. So one impala jumps over a tree to get away from a leopard or a lion, and the next impala smells that burst of smell coming from that gland, and it triggers an immediate jump response from whoever's following it. And of course impala jump spectacularly well, quite often jumping clear over predators and clear over bushes and trees, and that's what I'm told is the reason for having evolved that gland. It's quite unique to impala, that massive gland on the back of the foot. Good observation over there. There's a tiny baby elephant. A couple of weeks old, still following mom blindly, head down. You see she's coming through the bush there, and there's the little baby. See if we can get a better view of her. She should come out into the open over here, otherwise I will move the car. Seeing a youngster like that is always something quite special. Let's go and see if we can get a bit closer. Elephant numbers in the park have been increasing steadily from the early 1900s. In 1903, there were no elephants in the Kruger National Park. By 1905, there were three bulls that crossed in from Mozambique. And today, we have about 15 to 20,000, depending on what census reports you believe. Over that little youngster is wanting some milk. You can see him stretching up there, just stretching up between his mother's front legs to get some milk there. She's obviously wanting nothing of it. Oh, that is so cute, man. So elephant do really, really well in the Kruger National Park. Their numbers have been increasing. They had a little bit of a drop in their numbers in the 1980s due to quite intensive poaching pressure for tusks. Kruger National Park rallied to that threat, and poaching was, commercial at least, poaching was eradicated in the late 1980s into the 1990s. And elephants enjoyed and have enjoyed many years of relative peace and quiet on the back of that. With their numbers steadily increasing since then. Elizabeth in Minneapolis has asked me if I'm familiar with a place in Mozambique where elephants are nearly tuskless due to poaching pressure. Hey, Elizabeth, no, not a specific place. You find tuskless elephant almost everywhere in Africa. And yes, in areas where poaching is a little bit more prevalent than in others, you do find a higher instance of tuskless elephant. But you don't find entire populations of tuskless elephant. I'm not aware of it anyway. If you do have the reference to that, please feel free to email it to me. I'd love to know about it. And on that note, we are quickly going to go through to James, who has some dwarf mongoose on his walk, which is quite rare to get on foot. So before they run away, go through there. We'll see you in a bit.
You've been having an incredible time with some enormous animals, and we've been sitting here enticing these little dwarf mongoose out of their mound, and it is just so special to have them this close to us. We're probably about 10 meters from them. It's about 30 feet, and they're just starting to trust us enough to come out. We've been sat here for about 20 minutes, well, no, not quite, 10 minutes maybe, and we've made little sort of squeaking sounds, which is, well, some people might consider a little bit off, but what it's done is enticed them out. Because when they saw us coming, they were a bit nervous, and now there are two of them there, you can see. Isn't that just wonderful? Tiny little mongoose, and that's their little home. They'll live inside that termite mound, and they'll have a number of temporary refuges around here that they like to live in. But to have them this close to us on foot is so special, and we can't really move, because I think you'll find that they'll disappear back inside. Every so often they relax a bit, and then they look and see. There's another one come out the right-hand side of the mound. There he is. And now there's a third one in the middle. And if we stand here for long enough, I think what you'd find is the entire troop, probably about 10 of them. When we first arrived, there were about 10, would come out and sit on the top of the mound, sun themselves. And eventually, I mean, if we spent enough time, just like with the meerkats of the Kalahari, with whom Brian spent a huge amount of time, I think eventually these mongoose would just start to go about their business without worrying about us at all. So that would probably be a period of days and weeks as opposed to just a couple of minutes. Look at that. There's another little one there sticking its head out. It's so sweet. Look how shiny the coat is. Excellent condition. You know an animal's in good condition when its coat is shining in the sun. Incredible speed with which their heads move. It's always amazed me. If you look to the side, it's a slow movement. These things kind of flick their heads side, up, down, all around, always looking carefully. Obviously the threats that they face are physically substantially greater than the ones we do. One just had a bit of a yawn, that's why it was opening its mouth. They keep very, very gentle hours to the mongoose. They don't like to strain themselves too much. They're just enjoying, as I was when you last saw me, I was lying next to a pile of dung, just enjoying that feeling of the morning sun on my face and on my back. And look at them. Now, they'll go off eventually once they're warm enough and once they've decided that either that we are not a threat or once we've left. They'll go off and they'll forage around here and they'll eat anything from little spiders and scorpions. They do like to eat scorpions, possibly the odd tiny rodent, lots of lizards and that sort of thing, maybe a little bit of fruit. And they're largely carnivorous, and they'll forage around for most of the day, and then when it gets hot they'll rest in the shade, and they'll never be too far from a temporary refuge that lives, that exists in their territory. So this is probably in the middle of their territory, this little termite mound, and we'll stay here a little bit longer. Let's head across to Stef. Apparently that little elephant is suckling again. I think that is just a wonderful thing to be seeing. Please enjoy it and appreciate it. We'll stand here for a bit longer and see you just now.
This mom and baby or newborn elephant calf have stopped in the shade of this peltiforum tree, and that little baby is just showing you exactly why they are so adaptable. He's just followed his mom, brand new little baby, and you saw him kicking at the leaves and twigs, having watched mom only do it for a couple of days. There goes that funny tusked elephant again. I'm going to try as much as I can to try and follow this herd. They seem to be very relaxed with us. And I have no doubt that throughout the day you're actually going to be seeing more of these elephants. We're actually quite close to the Juma Dam, and it looks like by this afternoon they're going to be coming through to the dam for some water. It's the only water that is here at the moment, or close to here at the moment. And keep an eye on that Juma Dam, Cam, because that little baby will be very cute if you get to see him. If you get to see him playing in the water. I don't mean to disturb you. Don't worry. I just needed to crash over that one last bush. It's not a good entry into a sighting. They don't crash over at least one dry stick and make an absolute racket. Cute is that little guy. Have a look at that little guy just having an absolute roll in the grass. I have no idea what it's rolling in, to be quite honest. Just looks like he's having some fun. Not because he wants to have a sleep, he's busy playing over there with something. Always busy rolling in something, I don't know. It didn't look like he was smelling anything in the grass over there, but that's actually an elephant. It's not a dog. Oh, that's epic. And now it's, because it's such bizarre behavior, one of his cousins has come over, and there's mom. Also come over to see what's going on. Probably a previous calf, that actually, from that female. They stay in very close contact with one another, and quite often successive generations of babies would help to rear the next generation. So you do find that it's probably either a cousin or a sibling, more than likely a sibling. Excuse that. It sounded a lot worse than it actually is. It was just a branch busy scratching against one of the plates. Cloud cover is definitely increasing. I actually want to come and see here what this baby elephant is rolling in. He was rolling in nothing. He was just having some fun on the grass. I've actually lost sight of where this this baby is. I think he's in the bush off to our right hand side. How bizarre is that? I've managed to lose a... Okay, right in front of us. I was just about to say, my ego is going to take a big bashing over there. I was about to lose a baby elephant in the open here. Let's go forward a little bit, see if this female will allow us into her presence. She doesn't seem too perturbed. And that is good for us. Yeah, that youngster is busy playing with his, with another young elephant. Busy sharing a smell or sharing an experience or just touching one another. There you go. You can see over there that contact that's so important for elephant. Look at that trunk over the back. Playing with his ear. No. What are you doing? Stop bullying. That's lovely. And then, of course, Colleen in Canada has asked a very awesome question. Do babies use their mouth or their trunk to suckle? Colleen, they use their mouth to suckle because their nose or their trunk has no epiglottis. So their nose or their trunk goes straight through to their lungs and their mouth goes straight through to their esophagus and their tummy. They can't actually drink through their nose whatsoever. It's not a passage like we have. We can actually get water through our nose into our throat. And we have an epiglottis, our baby tongue stops any, when we swallow, our epiglottis blocks the trachea to stop food from going into our lungs. And when we're breathing, blocks our esophagus to stop air going into our tummies. Elephant don't have that, they just have one or another. Now these elephants have started to get moving again. James seems to have kept up with these dwarf mongoose on walk, which is phenomenal. And before they run away again, you're going to go back to him. We'll see you in a bit.
Isn't that amazing? We've now come to within 6 meters of these little mongoose. 3 of them we can see. There's a fourth one to the right of your picture. And they are fascinated by us. Brian, of course, who spent lots of time in Kalahari with the meerkats, said, let's just go a bit closer. He reckoned that we could call them out of the burrow, and that's exactly what's happened. Isn't that amazing? Now, they have a Shanga name, which is Matsigito, and it's an onomatopoeic name for the call that they make, and we've been trying to emulate that call, and that's initially what sort of pulled them out of the burrow to have a look at us. Because when we walked up here, oh, look at that. There, you heard it. That's us making a noise, obviously. And if you do that, sometimes they'll come a little bit closer. There we go. They are fascinated by us. Little pink noses, little red eyes. And they're just about to go off and forage. I'm sure they would go off and forage if they weren't looking at us so intently. They are fascinated by these large visitors that have come to their burrow. I'm always fascinated by how human their ears look. You can, at this distance, I mean at this astonishing distance of about 6 meters, you can almost see into their ears, and they're just so humanoid, very unlike a cat's ears or a dog's ears. And you can see when you look at their ears that they're so, well, I mean they're related, but they're very distantly related. Totally different family from the dogs and the cats. Just loving the bits of sun there. Now they're diurnal animals, and that means that they probably don't see that well during the night, probably better than us. And Catherine, in Texas, you've asked an interesting question about whether their hearing or their sense of smell or sight are more important or more acute. I think it's difficult to say, but I would say that it's probably their sense of smell. And that's simply because in order to forage, when you're that tiny, you can't really see a great deal of what you're looking for. You need to be able to smell bits of rotting flesh and perhaps the scent trail left by some ants or termites, or even the urine trail left by a tiny rodent. So I'd say that their sense of smell is probably extremely acute. That said, their eyes are certainly excellent, as are their ears. I'd love to just experience what they hear for a, you know, a brief while, just to understand how acute their hearing could possibly be. Well, this is really quite astonishingly special. We are standing so close to them. Now the mound, you can see there are a number of holes around the place, and the question is this, from Zumi Jody, is this mound still active? I would say no, it isn't. Apparently you can see some kind of invertebrate running around behind where the mongoose have just disappeared. I'll just see if we can pull them out again. Here they come. I don't think those are termites. They're probably flies and ants. There'll be all sorts running around here, but as in terms of a working, functioning termite colony, I think this one is done. There are trees growing out of it. It's actually, it's weathered down and eroded quite a lot. We're actually standing. Where we're standing is pretty much on the edge of where the once very large termite mound used to be. So I think what you'll find, they've taken a little bit of a fright. I think what you'll find is that there's one looking at us. Look at them. Isn't that wonderful? I think what you'll find is that this went dormant, probably as the result of an aardvark or ant bear attack. And you can see to the left-hand side of the mound, there is a big hole, and I wonder if that isn't what precipitated the fall of this once mighty termite colony empire that used to cover a large area here. Very kindly built burrows and homes for many, many other little creatures. I'm going to take one step closer and just see if they won't become completely confiding with me. What I'm going to do, actually, Brian, if I sit down here, what do you think they'll do?
I think they'll run to start.
Let's just see, because this is astonishingly special stuff. Brian is now stuck on a tree, he can't move here. Let me move for you.
Okay.
You're off. Okay, they've all disappeared. What we'll do is we'll just step a little bit closer here. Now we'll make our call and see if they once come out. we're now about 4 meters from that tiny little mongoose. That's gorgeous. This is absolutely unbelievable. They're looking around. They can hear bits and pieces in the grass around us. Oh, there's another mongoose there. Either another troop or perhaps an early foraging party. That's quite interesting. Can you see me, Brian? Just over there. There are another 3 or 4 mongoose. There, can you see them? And I'm sure they're from the same troop. There, running through the bush. Probably from the same troop, maybe an early foraging party, not a lazy bunch like this. The other thing that these ones might be are some youngsters that have been left behind to look after the really little ones that are inside the mound. And they may be allowed to go out and forage later, or perhaps they'll even be fed by some of the others returning later on. Oh, that's just so spectacular. mongoose, of course, always elicit questions about who and what they're related to. This is unbelievable. They're all coming out again now. And Anna Marie and Barbara have asked questions about whether they're related to meerkats or prairie dogs. Prairie dogs, probably not really. I don't know the exact sort of taxonomy of a prairie dog, but I don't think that they'll be closely related at all. I'm not sure what family the prairie dogs come from. But then meerkats, absolutely, they're from the same family called the Hesperidae, and those are the mongooses, and a meerkat is a mongoose. It's just, you know, it's just a different species of mongoose.
Suricata,
suricata in Latin. Thank you very much there, Brian. And these ones are, these have the wonderful Latin names, mongoose mongo, I think, if I'm not mistaken. Beautiful little Latin name. So they are in the same family, but not the same genus. Now what that means, if you're not into taxonomy, is that they are, for example, a leopard and a lion are in the same genus, both Panthera. One's Panthera pardus, that's a leopard, and one is Panthera leo, the lion. But a house cat, or a, say, a serval, is in a different genus. They are felis serval. So in the same way that a serval is related to a leopard, so would a mongoose or a dwarf mongoose be related to a meerkat. And I think you'd find that they are a lot more distantly related to a prairie dog. I don't know what family the prairie dogs come from. I suspect it's a family all on its own. Because you're in the New World there, and the continent split so many millions of years ago, you'll find that most of the mammal life is fairly unrelated. Let's just take a little bit step forward. Now, I was just saying perhaps these chaps here, still in the mound, which is quite late for them to be here, perhaps they are here as guards for some really little ones. And Christy, you want to know if perhaps this is the breeding time. As far as I know, mongoose are pretty unseasonal breeders. They'll breed any time of the year. You'll probably find that there's a peak breeding season during the wet, and that's because of the amount of insects that they eat. So it's easier for them to feed the babies if there are lots of insects and reptiles around during the summer months. But I don't think that would preclude them giving birth in winter. So most of the carnivores out here are not really seasonal. They might show a peak birth time. There are some others calling from just behind us, giving that Matsigito call. I'm just edging very slowly closer to this fellow and see what he does. Just sort of inch by inch by inch, and he's still watching it. This is amazing. And you don't have these experiences, of course, in a vehicle. Yeah, he's gone out the back. Well, one of them's gone out the back. Still one there in the hole. There we go. Looking up at us now from the right-hand side there, Brian. Just see the eyes shining. I've had a great look at their eyes. They're very red eyes. And Lewis in Buffalo, you want to know about the pupils, and that it appears to you that they're elongate rather than round. Lewis, I have to admit that I'm not seeing what you're seeing because I'm not standing behind the camera. I'm standing in front of it trying to edge my way closer.
They look like goat eyes.
Do they? Which means, are they elongated pupils? Oh, I see. So they're horizontally elongated. I don't know why that would be, other than, much like for some of the cats, it's an effective way of allowing more light in during the darkness. And I think they're also probably quite an effective way of closing them up quickly if they have to, during very bright light. But I think you'll find it's got to do with low light conditions. But more than that, I couldn't tell you at this stage. Brian, do you have any ideas? But great. I mean, astonishing that you're able to see what the pupil looks like from here. We're now, I've edged another meter closer while we've been standing here. So we're standing about 2.5 to 3 meters from them. There is one just outside, just over there. Very relaxed. And I think if we sat here for long enough, I think you'd find most of the rest of the troop would come out. We'll do one more little alarm call, and then I think we'll leave them. I don't want them to sit here and not go and eat because they're worried about us. But the one on the right is watching us. But the one inside is actually making little alarm calls, little contact matsigito calls. How very, very special indeed. What we'll do as we extract from this area is we'll walk around sort of at this distance and see if they're any the other side, and then we'll leave them to go off and forage for their breakfast. This, for me, is one of the most special experiences you can have in the wild, because it's slow, you've got to be considered about it, but when the reward you get from the patience is profound. To have spent this time with a completely wild animal less than 3 meters from it is just such a privilege. Yeah, they've all disappeared now. Now, of course, the most famous mongoose in history is Rikki Tikki Tavi from The Jungle Book. Now, Rikki Tikki Tavi was known as a snake killer. And Jane, you want to know if these mongoose are also snake killers. I will get back to you now. Sorry, and Dave and Jane, I missed your name there, Dave. Sorry, that's why I had to pause and just try and recall it by clicking furiously on my radio and getting Tara to tell me again. Dave and Jane, these mongoose, the dwarf mongoose are not huge snake killers. They will kill small snakes, but they won't kill big ones. What if you've seen mongoose attacking snakes in this part of the world, they are slender mongoose mainly. Now, slender mongoose is a lot bigger. Slender mongoose is about a foot long with a long tail, and they come in pairs or just solitary, and they will attack snakes, and they will fight cobras, and they're incredibly fast. A cobra is not a particularly quick snake. I mean, as a human being, you're actually fast enough. If a cobra sat up in front of you and tried to bite you, you could easily move your leg away fast enough. Well, not easily, but you could do it. Whereas if something like a puff adder were to strike at you, your reaction speed is nowhere near fast enough to get out of the way. But a cobra is not that quick, and the mongoose know that, and the mongoose are very quick. So they'll go in, they'll bite them, they'll get out, bite them again, and they will absolutely go for a cobra. Banded mongoose as well, which are slightly bigger, also live in big troops, and lovely bands across their backs. They will also kill snakes. So yes, there's a lot of snake killing. The dwarf mongoose is the one species that doesn't do a huge amount of snake killing because they're just very little. So they not like to avoid being bitten by snakes. And snakes, I mean, cobras get pretty big out here. You'll get cobras of probably 4 feet long sometimes. And that's a formidable enemy for a tiny little mongoose like that. But for a slender mongoose, you know, they'll absolutely have a go at them. Right, that was the most special little period. Beautiful. So we'll carry on walking through here, see what else we can spot. And there's clearly been a huge amount of aardvark or ant bear activity around here this isn't recent, this is very old. But we see a lot of it, and I think Stef showed you yesterday a pretty fresh aardvark hole. In fact, he probably climbed into it. And there were tracks of aardvark. We just don't see them because they're so nocturnal. And so we don't see a huge number of them. And as many of you will know, Tingana, who is one of our favorite leopards, of course, is a great connoisseur of aardvark flesh and hunting. And so when he's around, we definitely don't see them very much. But they're around. I mean, we've seen him. I think he's been pictured, what, with three of them, Brian?
Yeah.
It's three aardvark. So, I mean, there are lots of them around the place. I don't think those were the last three. Just give you an idea here of the size of an elephant's back foot. Here is my foot. Now, that's not a particularly big foot, but it's a size 7. And the elephant's big foot, of course, goes all the way around where my stick is tracing. So enormous, enormous feet. Brian's foot was probably almost the same size as this elephant's foot, actually. Brian, will you put your foot in there? There we go. So the elephant is probably a size 15, a size 12 that you've got in there. A vast, great foot. It is no coincidence that Brian ended up in the circus for a little while with feet that size. What's your head? I also found, I've visited this particular tree before on camera, and we found some green fruit a little while back, and today we found some purple ones, and we had another bite at them, but unfortunately this one doesn't have any. If we find some more, I'll show you. Bushman's grape, and you can see why they're called a grape. They're just starting to ripen, which is rather delicious. And we agreed that they tasted a little bit like a roast chicken dinner, if you can believe it. It's a bit of an odd thing for a fruit to taste like, but that is almost certainly what they did taste of. Sunday roast with a bit of a, well, it's kind of like having your chicken and your apple crumble mixed together. That's a bit like what the taste of that. It's quite sweet as well as tasting of roast chickens.
Chicken apple crumble.
Chicken apple crumble. Delicious. Should try it sometime. What is this here? Ah, now, we're going to start finding lots of these kinds of things. This is a chrysalis, I think. There is something metamorphosizing in that little piece of gloop. It might be a caterpillar turning into a moth, something like that. It might be probably not a mantis, but something like that. Lots and lots of caterpillars and other kinds of larvae, the dung beetle larvae, fly larvae, will be busy metamorphosizing, feeding, and then going into their pupas, metamorphosizing into their adult forms. And at night time, we have a great dissension of all sorts of bugs and flying things that are attracted to the light, lots of moths. And then as the flowers come out, you'll see the butterflies flitting about here. And it's just a very wonderful time of year. Here's another Bushman's grape, and we'll see if we can find any fruits on it. I wonder if it isn't a... Here we go, here we go. Here we go, Brian. I'm going to refeed you roast chicken and apple crumble in one mouthful. Delicious. That's not a particularly red one. Here's a red one for me. So if you eat the purple bit there, Now these ones aren't particularly sweet. This is just roast chicken. This is without the apple crumble mixed in. Yeah, not quite ripe yet. Lovely when they're purple. They're really quite delicious. Bad luck. Now, just taking you back to the dung beetle sighting that we had earlier, if you weren't with us, we had an amazing sighting of a tiny little dung ball or dung rolling beetle. And Barbara, you want to know, do they only lay one egg in the ball? Yes, they do only lay one egg in the ball, but that's not the end of it. They will then go back and do the same thing again. So they keep repeating that process throughout the season. So one dung beetle will definitely normally have more than one offspring, and they don't survive the... Just careful, you're right there. They just don't survive the dry season. So as soon as it dries out, they will die, but they will have laid eggs all over the place. And some of them don't lay eggs in balls, of course. Some of them just lay eggs underneath the dung. They'll use the dung up, and then they'll fly off and find more dung. And there's obviously, as you've seen on these walks, a plethora of dung around the place. And especially, you know, when it heats up a bit and we've had a bit more rain, you'll find around that herd of elephants that you were watching with Stef, huge herd of elephants, what you'll find is that the swarms of dung beetles around there will be amazing, because the amount of dung that they produce, I mean, they produce hundreds of kilograms of dung every day, that big herd of elephants. They are some of the most fascinating creatures that we get out here. And we've talked about elephants, so let's head straight back across to Stef, who's got a few more elephants for you. We'll keep on in this.
I must comment on the fact that I am very, very jealous for you being where you are with, or where you were with James, at least, with those dwarf mongoose on foot. I'm sure he's told you many times already that it's absolutely unique to get there. But we've come to the front of this herd of elephant and found a big bull elephant that was hiding in the brush in front of this herd. And he's just given us a bit of a head shake, standing in this very thick bush. As you can see, we can literally just see the top of his head and his head and his tusks. He's not the biggest elephant around. I would say that he's probably in his 20s, middle 20s. You can see he's also got a bit of a feeding notch on his tusk there. But Andrew's trying to get into frame there. I just think watching an elephant where you can't see the whole thing is almost as exciting as watching an elephant where you can see the whole elephant. See, the wind is busy blowing. We're now right in front of this herd of elephant that we were with the whole time, the one with the female with a funny trunk, tusk, and with a tiny youngster. I would say that this male elephant, this bull elephant that we're seeing, is part of this herd. I don't think that he is old enough just yet to be separated from the herd. I think that he was just walking in front. And he's busy eating some of the new shoots that are coming out underneath the trees. Now, I see most of the elephants around that have gone under trees or standing in the shade. Testimony that to the fact that the sun is quite harsh today. It's not a particularly hot day just yet, although I'm sure it is going to build up to be an absolute cracker. But already the elephant are moving into the shade. I'm going to get forward a little bit. Sorry, Andrew, I didn't mean to ambush you there. And just reposition slightly. Baby coming with his head held high, obviously picking up on some of the emotion coming through these ellies. They're incredibly good at reading body language, these elephants, I must be honest with you. And here comes this youngster. Watching baby elephant is a good idea of gauging adult elephant's behavior. They exhibit similar things, like that head up, ears out. It's just an elephant's way of looking at us. Their eyes generally look to the ground the whole time at what they're busy feeding on. So for them to get a good view of something as big as us, they've got to lift their head up. And it has the double effect of being quite intimidating as well. Obviously not on a youngster like that, but when you see it on an adult elephant, absolutely. Now, as is the habit of elephant, once they have moved out of open open bush into thicker bush like we have at the moment, they have the almost mystic ability of being able to disappear. They become invisible. And although we are parked literally in the middle of about 20 or 25 elephants at the moment, I can only really see fully one elephant. And it's going to require me to reposition again. So, and while we reposition, we're going to be going through to James to show you what damage elephants actually do to the bush, so that you can actually see firsthand with James on foot what it is that these elephants are doing to the bush. So we'll catch up with you in a little bit.
Great sort of link from Stef. Here you can see a cambrium tree that's been pushed out of the ground during the course of the winter months. They've left the bark completely alone, and what they were going for is the nutritious carbohydrates that come inside the roots of these cambrium trees. Elephants love them, that's why they push them over, and astonishingly this tree will not die. It'll just change direction and grow up towards the sky. We've had a wonderful walk this morning. Thank you for your questions and comments. As always, they've sparked some lively discussion, even off air. We've talked about the various things that you've asked, so thank you for them. Big thank you to Brian on camera. A big thank you to Tara, of course, and to, well, we've got a newbie in town at the moment, and that is our new friend, Gerald. Geraldine, she's a lady. And she, of course, is here because today is the last day of Jessica Biffy in Johannesburg. So a big shout out to her. Goodbye, Jessica. We hope to see you soon. We are both
we're both
in a state of devastation that you're leaving. Bye-bye.
We are.
And stay safe wherever you are going in the world. I think it's Australia. Look after yourself. Don't eat too many kangaroo burgers. Yeah. And we'll see you on the flip side. From us, Brian and James, we will see you, the rest of you, not Jessica, of course, this afternoon at 4 o'clock. Back to Stef for the elephants. See you later.
Ciao.
Now, just talking about that mystic ability of elephant to disappear into the bush, as you can see this youngster hiding out in the shade. His trunk and his face almost look identical to that branch that you're busy having a look at over there. Almost the same pattern as well. We are sitting in the middle of this herd of elephant, and this is where we're going to be closing off the show today. It's been quite a bizarre day. Started off with an elephant and we're finishing off with an elephant. And it's been a beautiful day. It looks like it's going to be pretty cloudy this afternoon. With the wind, I doubt it's going to get to be a blistering day. But we'll be able to tell you more about what today is happening this afternoon on the Sunset Drive. And so, literally, I just want to say thank you to Jess once again. It's her last day on the show with us. She's moving on to greener pastures, she's going to Australia for a bit, as far as I know. So we just want to say thank you to Jess for all her hard work over the last couple of months, and for really just being such a fantastic person. And we wish you well. James has had a fantastic sighting today. So I think between James and Brian and that dwarf mongoose sighting that they had, I mean, wow. And then we've just had a really good time with elephant today. I've really enjoyed today's, definitely with the elephant drinking out of the pan, and then with us sitting with this herd of elephant, different tusk shapes and babies and doing everything else. I've had fun today. At least from my side, from Andrew's side, from Lou on the vehicle, we are going to say goodbye. Thank you to Tara and to Jerry. Well done, Jerry, on your first day in the seat. And we look forward to seeing you on the Sunset Drive. So have a good day wherever you are in the world. Ciao.